There are a great many Americans, and it doesn't really matter what side of the political divide you may be on, or multiple sides of the political divide you may be on, who believe that we've reached a point where the rhetoric in politics has become a little too heated. Now, and I host a radio talk show, so I'm familiar with the criticism as well as also dishing it out when I think people are out of line as well. It tends to go both ways in this particular role. There was a meeting of legislators, many of them working at the state level, but they had a national get-together in Denver, Colorado, just a few days ago, and a small delegation went from Idaho as well, including State Representative Melissa Wintrow from Boise. She's joining us this morning. She's a Democrat, but she was there as well in a bipartisan sense because she went along with some colleagues who are Republicans, and there was a large discussion on civil discourse that took place at this event. First of all, ma'am, welcome to our program.
Thanks for having me this morning. It's my honor to be with you.
Well, I thank you. And to begin with, a conference like this, is this a good start, or is there a view that perhaps that we're never going to get anything back? There have been times, obviously, in history where back in the 1800s you had people caning each other in the Capitol building in Washington. So we've had moments that have been worse, obviously, but we've also had moments that are likely better. Is there a sense that we can put the genie back in the bottle?
Well, I feel really hopeful about the state of civil discourse in our country. I know it's been really tough lately, but organizations that, you know, I'm involved in, along with Representative Kelly Packer and Senator Chuck Winder, I feel really hopeful. The conference that I attended in Denver, I went there with Representative Packer and Senator Winder, and we went there to basically facilitate discussions around civil discourse with majority leaders across the country. It's part of an annual conference they do, and they determined they were going to dedicate a half day, most of their program, in fact, to discussing civil discourse. So I think that's very hopeful that current and emerging leaders are saying, hey, we want to engage in a way that we understand each other better so we can solve big problems instead of argue about them.
I saw a piece yesterday, and I've forgotten where the exact publication was online, but it was a young man, and he wrote to an advice columnist, and the son is a liberal Democrat, and his dad is a conservative Republican, and he said, I don't feel like I could talk to my dad anymore. And then the advice columnist said, remember, your dad is a human being, and so are you, and you might want to step back for a moment and look at it that way. Do we have to sometimes to take that approach and realize that the other side isn't comprised of some sort of gang of monsters?
Bill, I think you hit the nail right on the head, and so did that advice columnist. I think the heart of civil discourse is looking at people as people and not as objects in our way, and that we're all human beings. We all have the same goal. Well, different goals, but we have goals. We have desires. We have families. We have fears. We have hopes. And the program I'm involved with, Next Generation, I'm a co-chair of a national network of state legislators who are dedicated to leading with civility. And as a part of that, you know, we are trying to do workshops with other legislators called, building trust through civil discourse. And we build that trust when we see each other as human beings. And we need to, I think, really focus on that and not always the stances and positions. But, you know, there are people behind those stances and positions, and they're human beings with feelings and families and goals and so forth. So I think you hit the nail right on the head.
I think, though, that on the state level, and maybe it's a cultural difference, too, a lot of what we see going on at the national level has been there a long time already. But I get the impression that in places like Idaho, and maybe it's the Mountain West and the Midwest, that things aren't quite to the point where they are nationally. I'll give you a good example. I write a local newspaper column. So does the leader of the Twin Falls County Democrats. I read her work, and I think she's obviously well-intentioned. I don't know that she feels that way about me, but I read the work, and I just do not see a lot of viciousness going on in regional politics.
That's great to hear. You know, I think, again, the organization that I'm involved in, Next Generation, it's part of the National Institute for Civil Discourse. We focus on the state level, And Senator Winder, Representative Packer, and I are all trained to facilitate workshops with other state legislators. So we go out to other states. I went to Arkansas last year and helped facilitate a workshop. So this program is by legislators for legislators. And in that discussion, we're role modeling, leading with civility. So I think at the state level, maybe, you know, it's not as big as a bureaucracy. We know each other. I find that the Idaho House is very congenial and welcoming. And, you know, I'm in my second term, and I've always felt welcome there and really developed some great relationships with folks that I vote against all the time. And I care deeply for many of my colleagues. So maybe at the state level, it's not as big a machine, so we know each other a little bit better. And we're closer to our constituents, I think, as well. So that might help matters at the state level.
Our guest is State Representative Melissa Wintrow. She's a Democrat serving the Boise area. We're at 912 at 74. Bill Colley with you on Top Story on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. I was reading, in fact, I saw a video online last week. And look, it's no secret that when you look around the Idaho legislature, and I don't think that she would dispute this, you have a legislator from Northern Idaho who takes no prisoners, and Heather Scott has been a rather strong personality since she was sent to represent her constituents. She had a video out last week, though, and I think what she was saying is she's okay with people. Mm-hmm. She's okay with people who might be attacking her, but she had gone to an Independence Day parade, and she had photographed some young children who were decked out in red, white, and blue. And she was citing what some of the comments were, people attacking the children, which, again, a legislator develops a thick skin. But when we see something like that, that part of it, maybe it's the anonymity that people have, too, as well. We're never, it seems, going to be able to stop that. And I don't know, maybe it's the internet age. But is there a way to at least deal with that where we don't all lose our heads?
You know, I think we can stop it because we all have control of our own actions, speech, and thoughts, right? You know, part of the important part of the group that I'm involved in, it engages state elected officials, it engages media and citizens, and it says we're all in this together and that we all choose how we show up. We all choose if we're going to act with civility or not. So every single one of us, citizens, elected officials, media, we make those choices, and we can control whether we're attacking kids or not. I don't approve of that, and I do think that's inappropriate. And so what I would also suggest is when I'm on social media and I see somebody post something negatively on my page, I confront it. And, you know, I recognize that there's frustrations, but we will have discussions with civility and respect for others and not lambasting anyone. I just don't think that's productive, and it doesn't feel good to me. You know, my mother on her deathbed sent me a message loudly and clearly about how we choose to show up. She was dying a very hard death. She was suffering. She would have been justified to lash out and be mean, but she was the kindest, gentlest soul. She thanked her nurses. She smiled. She said good job to others. And, you know, she really demonstrated to me on her deathbed, you choose every minute how you show up. You can't control what happens to you sometimes, but you can control your reaction.
I remember the movie Untouchables where I believe Sean Connery was playing a character, and he said, you know, they take out one of ours, we take out one of theirs. And it was a good movie line at all. But it seems that a lot of politics has descended into that. And when somebody does step out of line on the right or the left, there's always a demand that that person needs to lose their job. They need to go live under a bridge and be isolated or in a cave for the rest of their lives. That's the part that, look, I realize it's a heated business. Mm-hmm. And the reason we do have different political parties is because not everybody agrees. There was a writer today at the Washington Times, and she was citing a newspaper columnist named Ira Madison III. And this fellow Madison, who was a liberal Democrat, had referred online to Sarah Huckabee Sanders as, get this, a butch queen. Now, to me, that might cross the line a little bit to say something like that publicly, but I wouldn't necessarily demand that he lose his job or anything like that. But it is clear that it goes both ways. I mean, people are throwing bombs from both the right and the left in these situations.
You know, No one should be doing that. And as I kind of, when I work with students, citizens, myself, my colleagues, I think, what am I doing to make the world a better place? How is my speech, my actions, my behaviors, my decisions making the world a better place? And by calling people names is wasting space, and that's not appropriate. I think the bigger part of civility, you know, civility is all about engaging in a way so we can understand each other, to enhance learning and understanding. And a major part of civility, I think, is humility, is recognizing that I'm not always right, I can be wrong, and to be humble and recognize when I am wrong or when I don't have the answers, so I can go look for those and not have to have some ego or face or so forth. So, you know, I think I would encourage everyone when they think about, you know, we think about our actions, to think about listening and learning instead of just, you know, listening to respond and debate. How do I understand this other person and their feelings? Because they're human beings, no matter what.
Our guest is Melissa Wintrow, and she's a state representative and joining us this morning. We've got a couple of minutes left before we wrap things up. We're at 75. Bill Colley with you on KLIX. After the shooting at the congressional baseball practice, I think a lot of people are asking, could this get any worse? Do you think that things could get worse, or was that the wake-up call that maybe pulls us back from the brink?
You know, what's interesting is the National Institute for Civil Discourse was founded after Gabrielle Giffords, the congresswoman from Arizona, was shot in 2011. She was at a town hall, kind of at a grocery, and 13 other people, I think, were wounded. Some other people were killed. I mean, that was kind of a wake-up call. That's why that National Institute was founded. This is so unfortunate. I mean, acts of violence are, just shocking. It certainly is. I don't know if it's a wake-up call, but it certainly better alert us that we have got to listen to each other, and we have to resort to discussion, not violence. It is shocking, and there is no words can express the sadness we felt, probably all of us, and the care that we felt for the folks who were injured and their families.
I was going to say, if we move beyond this, we're essentially talking riots or civil war, and I guess most people aren't really prepared for that potential.
You know, I think, too, when civility arises, it's typically when people feel they're silenced and they have no way to enter the communication or the dialogue. So, you know, as a state official, I take very seriously to create an approachable setting around me and listen to people. I want to do everything I can not to silence discussion or viewpoints. I have Republican constituents. I listen to them. So I think we can all, in leadership positions and positions of formal authority, do all we can to make sure we're listening, hearing all the voices and sides, and making sure people feel included.
Well, Representative, I'd like to thank you for your time today. Noble project. Let's hope we actually we see some fruits come out of all of this.
Well, thank you for having me. And again, let's stress, we're all in this together. Elected officials, citizens, media, we're all doing it together, and I have hope.
Well, talk to you soon at some point.
Thank you so much for your time and having me today.
All right. Take care now. Melissa Wintrow is a state representative joining us this morning, and she mentioned she attended a conference in Denver last week, a bipartisan conference, and civility was among those discussions that took place. We're at 20 minutes after 9. Oh, Billy Ray Cyrus. Doesn't that make you feel old? I mean, he wore a mullet. Bill Colley with you this morning on Top Story on News Radio 1310, KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. I heard him do this live. I was at a concert. I took my daughter and one of her friends to a concert in, gosh, this was 10, 11, maybe 12 years ago. And so we went to a state fair, and Billy Ray was doing a free concert, and they wanted to go on the rides, and I wanted to hear some of the concert. He does a song that I usually use on Memorial Day on this program, and it talks a little bit about an old veteran that he knew, which was a much better song than Achy Breaky Heart, but it never got the attention. And my daughter and her friend, they didn't want to be there. They wanted to go. Come on, come on, come on. And then all of a sudden he mentioned that there was a camera on stage, and they were filming the crowd for his daughter's TV show, which was on the Disney Channel at the time. And all of a sudden, these two little girls completely forgot about the rides. Started waving for the cameras. Bill Colley with you on Top Story this morning on News Radio 1310. KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. We have a caller with us at 922. Caller, you're up next. You're on the air.
Your guest was great. If all Democrats were like that, we could get along. But I look at Democrats and I see rules for radicals. Every time you say something, they attack you viciously, call you names, talk over you. And then I look at the riots. It's all from the left.
I have to say one thing. The Democrats who appear on this program, and we've had Michelle Stennett, we've had Matt Erpelding, and we had Melissa Wintrow today, they seem to be of a more, how shall we put it, they're of a calmer variety when it comes to Democrats. They don't appear to be at all radical. But maybe that's more of an Idaho thing, as I was trying to point out. We don't seem to have those battles here that they would have maybe in Sacramento and especially in Washington.
Well, I sure hope we could all get along, like she said, but it just seems that the conservatives and, you know, the Tea Party, peaceful demonstrations and accused of violence, yet when the radical left demonstrates and attacks people with weapons and sticks and rocks, you know, it's just a demonstration.
And a lot of that, I think, is media-driven, which is unfortunate as well, because the media has decided to pick sides. And if it would just do its job as a nonpartisan observer, we might not have all of this going on.
Well, I hope we can get together again. Thank you.
Hey, thank you much for the telephone call. 924, Bill Colley with you on Top Story this morning. Telephone number 736-0300, 736-0300. You see it occasionally. I remember hosting a radio talk show, and it was right after my station carried Michael Savage's show. And Savage is, he takes no prisoners. I've used that phrase already this half hour, but he takes no prisoners. And Savage, one day I had the show on, and he was talking with Chuck Schumer, and the two of them were talking about the Dubai, remember the Dubai ports deal? Well, they were both on the same side, and they joked about the fact, first of all, they're you know, Jewish guys from New York City. So they already had something in common, and you know, they could talk about some old neighborhoods and the like. And one of them said to the other, yeah, I told friends I was going to be on your show tonight. And they said, what? But on that topic, they were united. 926. But it doesn't happen a lot. We have to admit that. 74. We have a caller with us. Caller, you're up next. You're on the air.
Oh, hey, we've all got relatives, you know, and family that have fought for our country to defend its values. And our freedom. How is it that a person can remain, friendly on decent terms with someone that's actively trying to destroy your country from within?
Yeah.
That's the problem I have with these people, because, you know, the Democrats, there's so many of them that are actively involved in trying to destroy the United States of America and the foundation that it's based on. They don't like our Constitution, and they don't like our freedoms that we have, and they're trying to direct that. How do you remain civil to someone that's doing that to your country that you love?
I think it's a point well taken, and thank you for the call. I have a friend of mine. We worked together in television back in the 1990s at two different stations, and we became, you know, just great friends. He's a liberal Democrat. He grew up in Washington, D.C. in the inner city. But he also spent 21 years in the U.S. military, and then when he retired from the military, he'd been working in Navy TV. He did 4 years, get this, 4 years in the Air Force and 17 in the Navy before he finally retired after, as I say, getting his 20 in, and he retired at 21 years. I said to him one time, why did you leave the Air Force and jump over to the Navy? And he said, I was a kid, and people told me they had better parties in the Navy, which didn't turn out to be true, but it got his television career started. But I still talk to him. We're quite civil to each other, even though we know that we disagree on a lot of major issues. And when I was still back on the East Coast, I'd get in the car and I would drive across the Chesapeake Bay Bridge and I would meet him outside of Nationals Park and we'd go to baseball games together. And we'd sit there in the hot sun and just, you know, reminisce and watch a ball game, and it was great fun. But we had things in common outside of politics that I think helped us out a great deal. And again, he's not one of these guys looking to burn the country down. He's very proud of having served the country for 21 years. He would never, ever do that. What gets me is the people out there, though, who think that we all should. I keep hearing, well, they think that civility is one thing. But you'll have those friends and neighbors who'll say to you, why can't they all just get along or come to some sort of an agreement? And I always use, because it's the most stark issue, take the issue of abortion. Where would there be compromise? Think about that for a moment. It's almost like Solomon. Are you going to split the baby in half and say, well, we're only going to abort half of it? And that's what I think a lot of people out there, those relatives or friends or neighbors you may have who say, well, you know, how come they just can't come to some sort of agreement? On some issues, there's never going to be any agreement, which is why we have political parties, and political parties try to get control in a majority so they can follow through with some of these plans. At least the views of the people in their own party who may put them into office. And again, that is the most stark example, but there are a lot of different examples about that. I believe that healthcare would be much better served by having a competition, a lot of competition with plans being offered versus a system of a single-payer system, that is a government-run healthcare system, like they have in England, which we now know some of the moral issues that are involved there because they've been front and center over the last few weeks. Now, some people out there think the government should have that responsibility so the government could make everything more fair. But I haven't ever seen throughout history where anything like that has worked. We're never going to have agreement on those issues. And it's all or nothing. You either want one or you want the other. But it doesn't mean I'd have to give a Democrat a punch in the nose just because they support some sort of socialized medicine in this country. 9:30, Bill Colley with you on Top Story on News Radio 1310. KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. It's 75 right now. We've got a lot more to go before we wrap up the day. I've got a long list. Speaking of differences between the political parties, some of the social issues, especially this one now on whether you're a boy or a girl, a couple of notes on that on the way.